Hey guys, good morning. It's Cam. This is Apollo. Say hi, bud. Really quick capture for you. So Apollo has separation anxiety. So does Zen. I would say Onyx does as well. Even Mika had a little bit of that going on, but they're all doing amazing. He's the last one to go out for potty break. And I just wanted to point something out to you guys. So this gets exponentially easier when you have the right tools. Like he's on e-collar for sure. That's helpful and easier because the timing of applying pressure is more precise and it can be more intense. However, you do not need anything but your body. Okay. I'm in my slippers to have this conversation with your dog. And it's incredibly important and powerful that you do pay attention to this detail, specifically if you have a dog that has issues of separation anxiety, or we call togetherness addiction. If they don't respect when you set a boundary, so if you tell them to stay and they don't stay, these are scenarios that are playing out based on how they view the relationship, right? If they're pushy on the walk and they're charging ahead, or they're scanning and reactive all the time, same issue behind that behavior, if you ask me. It's arousal, it's attitudinal. The dog is accustomed to taking up space and you yielding to them. So when Apollo first came in, he really had this issue where, you know, you would claim space from him and he would actually plant himself firmly and resist. And part of that's just his insecurity. He didn't know what was going on. He's not used to having this clarity of boundaries conversation. He was unsure where he is, what's going on. Lots of reasons for that that are fair and understandable, but they're also bad habits. They're very bad habits that have been patterned. He's a very large, very strong, solid dog. Let's go. So over time, what I see often happens, come here, is, you know, a large dog like this gets used to throwing their weight around and taking up space. And when you have somebody who doesn't know how to navigate it, look at how he yields to me right now without any other tool but my body. Come here, bud. Good boy. Let's go. So he used to plant himself. It would be an absolute contact conversation, right? Where I'd have to push into him and use my body to take up space. Now he knows that the polite thing to do is move away and give me space. This is really cool. Good boy. Let's go. I know I'm using you to teach. Come on. So right here, why we're recording this, specifically at the threshold, good boy, I expect all my dogs coming or going to let me claim this space, give me respect of this threshold, so that when they transition in and out, the arousal comes down. We don't have dogs racing out, flying off the handle, reacting at the boundaries, the fences, things like that, right? Or getting in fights with each other, because we've brought that brain noise down and we've established, hey, you come into this space, I'm in charge of it, right? And that at every intersection, even these tiny little moments, I care about how you treat me and that you give me respectful eye contact. Good boy. And you wait patiently for me to invite you. So let's go. On my terms, he gets to come along. But this is what's so cool, is like now he really understands to give space. Even if it's inside, I can take up space and I can send him away. And this is going to be really important long term, good boy, to him being successful at navigating no more separation anxiety, right? If you can't claim space in a threshold, if you can't send your dog away from you, like here's my kitchen, if you can't send your dog out of the kitchen and you know, take up the space and have them respect that, see how he kind of is like, wait, my insecurity tells me I don't know what we're doing right now. If you can't send him away and get this claimed, that's where you're going to see a lot of like resource guarding issues between dogs. They'll get in fights to challenge each other over the possession of this space. All kinds of different things can happen here. So very, very important, super basic. Again, I only need to use my body ultimately. Let's go. He just has a slip lead on. And then anytime we do a threshold, look at how he yields. Look at that. And then if I want to take up more space, I only have to walk toward. Good boy. That's so good. Let's go. These are going to be really, really important rules for his family to uphold. So they'll get to watch this and see. This is the sequence of what it should look like, no matter whether there's only him or his housemate dog. She'll be joining us at the end of the week here for the final week of board and train. And they've been having some fighting issues. Let's go. Apollo, come on. So when they're both here, we'll enforce the same expectation with both dogs. They'll both need to move through thresholds very politely and respectfully. No pushing, no shoving, no dogs going before people. And this is going to be a really, again, important way to elevate their understanding of the pack dynamic being subject to our decision making, right? Us giving permission for them to be included. Good boy. And then it's going to massively help us with getting him to be more natural consistently about respecting pressure. He is also learning to do the treadmill. We're doing some different things with him that'll be practical for this family to help drain energy and deal with his anxiety. But number one is just that propensity for these large dogs over time to learn to throw their weight around. They're fast, they're pushy, they're strong. I mean, if he plants himself, you guys, it was like hitting a brick wall, that chest of his, like a bull terrier. And so, you know, people give up. They get tired. They get frustrated if they're not prepared or trained on what to do and the details to pay attention to or the timing. They will often lose those battles. And then cumulatively, that tells the dog over time, hey, you really do own the space. But for an insecure dog like him, that's very stressful. That's not a comfortable headspace to be in, to be insecure and in charge, right? So you got to recognize that about our dogs. A lot of them are inherently insecure. They don't have good environmental conditioning from puppyhood. They don't have solid nerve. If they started out in the world very early on from both a genetic and a developmental standpoint, not having confidence and balance, then they move through the world with people around them not taking initiative to be the leader, and it perpetuates even more of the stuff that we don't like that's often rooted in anxiety and just a dog taking over and doing what they think they need to do when they're not actually rational. So everybody else is on place here, chilling and hanging out for a moment. We're getting ready to set up cognition testing. I just wanted to make sure to share this with you because he really does show a good example of that transition from where we started to understanding that this is a manners game here, always coming, going, same with the crate, and mom and dad are gonna have to uphold that big time. That's gonna be a key detail. And any of you guys that are getting your dogs from us post board and train, they'll be off leash reliable to enforce it once the training is done. And then of course, e-collar makes it 1,000,000% easier because you now can press that button and add pressure as you claim the space. And for a big dog, it's much clearer for them than just your small body. I'm only 5'4", so I'm a small person up against this guy. You have to really understand how to throw your energy around and be confident in delivering those spatial pressure boundaries. A lot of owners struggle with that. So hopefully this is helpful, you guys. Let me know if you have questions or if you get busy improving your thresholds today with your dog. I would love to hear about it, and I love to see it in the comments.